Hi guys, in this presentation we shall learn more about I2C protocol. So in the previous lectures we have seen already that how exactly data is transferred between master and slave using clocks, and then afterwards we seen how exactly we put data on the line. Before transferring the data from master to slave, we need to tell that okay, I'm starting the transmission. Okay, so in order to tell that I'm starting the transmission, we have to start the communication, right? So in order to start the communication using these lines, right, it is SCL, this SDA, okay, whatever the line you consider. Now how can I do this using these two lines? That is the criteria. Remember one thing, whenever the clock is high, the SDA line should goes from high to low. Okay, what I mean is, see, whenever the clock is high, it is in high state. Okay, clock, okay, whenever the clock is in high state, SDA line should be goes from high to low, which means somewhat it's look like, okay, you can see that here the clock is high and we see the transaction of SDA line from high to low. So this condition is known as start condition. Okay, remember, whenever the SDA line goes from high to low when clock is high, it is known as start condition. And opposite of it, which means whenever the SDA line goes from low to high, then it is considered as a stop condition. We can see like this here, transaction from low to high is considered as a stop condition. Okay, it is considered as a stop condition. Now how we write this in programmatical way, we'll see. I'm writing a function called start. Okay, it doesn't return anything, so I'll put a void. Okay, so in parameters also it doesn't require anything, I'll put void. Okay, so first what I have to do is I have to make the STA line from high to low, right? That is the main criteria. I'll simply write like STA equal to 1, which means it is high, and STA equal to 0, which means it is low. From high to low, it is done by this. Okay, now this should be done only when the clock is high, so I'll write like clock is high. So we'll just simulate it, whether how it works or not, we'll see. Okay, first I'll make STA 1. Okay, consider this is an STA. I'll make STA 1. I'll make clock high. After this only clock will be high, right? I'll make clock high. Consider this is in high condition. Okay, now you can see clock is high and STA is also high. Now I'll make STA as low. I'll make STA as low. Okay, it is continuous like this. Now you can see that at this position the clock is high and the transaction of STA line from high to low. Okay, that is what this condition says. Okay, so this function will work perfectly. Next, I need to write this stop condition. So void stop, again we don't need to do any parameter passing in that. And how can I write this? See, observe something here. I have to make this SDA line from low to high, right? So I'll make like STA from low to STA high. Okay, I have make this. This should be done when the clock is high, right? Whenever, see, STA is 0 here. Okay, so I'll write like STA is 0. Okay, STA is 0 and the clock is 1. I'll make clock as 1. Remember, this is clock and this is STA. Okay, now I'll make STA as 1. STA as 1 and it continues like this. Okay, at here this is high. Okay, and this is transactions from low to high, which means it is in stop condition. Okay, in the previous lecture I already said that for every device there is an address. Okay, while in our device EEPROM we have also a device address which consists of 8 bits. Okay, in 8 bits there are first 4 bits are fixed, like 1010, and there are another 4 bits like A2, A1, A0, which bits have control of the programmer, okay? And here read or write. Now here is the interesting case. See, in order to make this work, I have to fill these bits, okay? These 3 bits are not registers. Remember, these are pins. Actually, physically pins are there. So we need to connect to plus VCC or ground in order to make it 1 or 0. Okay, remember that thing. Consider like this is an EEPROM. Physically, there will be a pins available there, like A2, A1, A0. Okay, so in that we have to connect to plus VCC or to ground. Okay, it depends on you. Okay, we have an unique address up to 8 devices. Okay. Now here is a thing, it is a read and write. Now what is read and write? Let us think in this way. Suppose if you have an memory storage, okay? In that memory storage, either you can store the data or you can take the data, which means I can write the data or read the data, okay? In order to specify that I want to take the data or I want to store the data, there is a specific bit is there, okay? For 0 it is write and for 1 it is read. So now we'll see the data sheet and observe some of the things on that which will be used in the programming. Okay, see, I already said that there are physically pins are available here. See, these are the pins which are available, okay? A0, A1, A2, which means I can physically connect this to plus VCC or ground, okay? And then at below you can see that see here there are start and stop conditions, okay? You can see here whenever the clock is high, when data line goes from high to low, which means it's a start condition. Already we have discussed there, okay? Whenever the clock is high, the data line goes from low to high, which means a stop condition, okay? Already this is also we have discussed. See, this is the device address we already discussed. We are working with 1K/2K, which means I have 3 pins which are in our hand, okay, which we can use to give the address to the EEPROM. And here it is read and write, okay? In read and write, I already said that 0 means write and 1 means read. I want to show you. Let's see. See here, a read operation is initiated if the bit is high, okay? Which means if I put that bit 8 bit is 1, then it will be read operation. If it is 0, then it is a write operation. Okay, now I want to write the data in the EEPROM, so we'll use byte write. Okay, so what is byte write? See, if you understand this waveform, okay, you can easily write the program. First, it is in start bit. Already we have discussed that whenever we start the communication, we should initially start, okay, we initially start the communication. And then here it is 1, it is 0, it is 1 and it is 0, which means 1010, which means it is the first 4 bits of the device address which are fixed. Okay, and these are variable, so that's why it represents like this. See, 1 or 0 1 or 0 1 or 0. Since it is a write operation, for write operation we usually use 0, right? So it is 0. Okay, so first we start the communication, after that we'll send the device address. Okay, after sending the device address including the write operation, we'll get an acknowledgement. We'll see what is acknowledgement later. For the time being, acknowledgement is nothing but whenever we send something, the slave will receive. After receiving the slave, it will give an acknowledgement that okay, I have received the data. How it says, we'll discuss later. For the time being, just remember it acknowledgement. It acknowledges, which means it received the data. After that, there is a word address, okay, which means in the memory the address in which place I have to write the data. Okay, that address you can count like 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, okay, 8 bits. And after that again acknowledgement, which means okay, I got the address. Again data, obviously data, suppose I want to store a data called capital B, I'll send it through 8 bits, okay, and then acknowledgement and then stop. See, first we'll see this is how a byte write works. So in the data sheet we have seen that it has some algorithm, right? First we'll start the communication. After that I need to give the device address, okay, remember device address. See, logically you can think like, see, there is a device, it has some address, okay, inside memory it has an address, okay. So in order to access this memory, first we have to access this device. So that's why first we have to say the device address and what operation we are doing, either read or write, okay. After receiving we need to confirm that okay, it received properly. So that's why we need an acknowledgement. After that acknowledgement we need to send this address, okay, that address, and again we need an acknowledgement. After that we need to send the data, okay, so that data will store at this location, okay, and we need an acknowledgement, we will stop the communication. This is nothing but our common sense logic, okay. First we'll send, again we'll take acknowledgement, send, take an acknowledgement, send, take an acknowledgement. See, this also have some logic. See, before storing the data we should know where we have to store the data, okay, address and which device, okay. So it has a proper logic in it, okay. So don't try to mug it up, just think logically. And after that, what is an acknowledgement? After receiving some data we need to tell that okay, we received the data. So how can we tell? What we'll do is slave, it will simply pull the STL line to low, okay. So this is how the slave will tell that okay, I have received the data, okay. By making the STL line low, master will confirm that okay, the data which I have sent is received by the slave, okay. You can see that the start condition, okay. So start condition is nothing but whenever the clock is high, the STL line must go from high to low, okay. In stop condition, clock is high, STL line should go from low to high, okay. Now this address, okay, in this address these are fixed and these are varied, okay. Since there are 3 are varied, 8 number of EEPROMs can be addressed, uniquely addressed, and in that 8 bit we can use either to read or write the operation, okay. Slave gives acknowledgement to master by making the STL line low, okay. Now this is how we send the data. This is how the frame looks like, okay. Start condition, we send the device address and then we take the acknowledgement, we write the word address, and we take the acknowledgement, we write the data, and we take the acknowledgement and we stop the transmission, okay. So this is how I2C protocol works. In the next tutorial we shall learn more about these concepts, okay.